Welcome to ACC 14. I'm Donna Arnett, immediate past president of the American Heart Association. I'm here with Mark Creager, the incoming president-elect of AHA. And we're going to discuss the Symplicity 3 trial. So, Mark, tell us a little bit about the design of Symplicity 3.
Okay, so Symplicity 3 was a trial looking at the renal sympathetic denervation in patients with resistant hypertension. So that's defined in this case as a patients who had a systolic blood pressure greater than 160 millimeters of mercury despite maximal tolerated doses of three antihypertensive medications, which included a diuretic.
You know, when I noticed the trial results presented this morning, the average number of drugs for each of those groups was five.
Five drugs.
So they were really heavily medicated.
Indeed, because these were people who really had pretty confirmed resistant hypertension. So there were 535 patients randomized in this trial. It was a 2-to-1 randomization. And the primary endpoint was the office-based blood pressure, the change in the office-based blood pressure between enrollment and a 6-month follow-up period.
So two randomizations to the Symplicity device, the catheter, and one to the sham.
Right. So let me underscore the fact that this was a sham-controlled trial. So patients who consented to participate in this trial all underwent renal angiography. And those randomized to sympathetic denervation did actually undergo the catheter-based procedure that was intended to denervate the sympathetic nerves along the renal artery of each kidney. And those who underwent the sham procedure underwent renal angiography but did not undergo the denervation.
And in prior Symplicity trials, 1 and 2, they weren't sham controlled.
That is correct. The first trial did not have a sham control. It was just best medical therapy. And the second trial also did not have a sham control.
So what did you find?
So the findings in this trial, much to most people's surprise, was that there was no significant difference in the primary endpoint of office-based blood pressure or the secondary endpoint, which was ambulatory blood pressure, between the two groups. It was interesting in that when you compared each group at the time of enrollment to 6 months later, there was a decrease in systolic blood pressure, about 14 millimeters of mercury in the denervation group and about 12 millimeters of mercury in the sham control group. But there was no significant difference in the change in systolic blood pressure between the two groups.
Right, just about a 2 millimeter difference between those two groups.
Right.
It's interesting because, you know, in clinical trials of antihypertensive therapies, we always noted a large placebo effect, but I didn't know that it would extend and be as large for a sham procedure. Were you surprised?
Well, I was surprised primarily based on the preclinical work that was done to support this concept and the prior clinical studies, which have really shown impressive changes in blood pressure with the denervation approach. And I did not anticipate that we'd have such a dramatic effect in the sham control group.
So the ambulatory blood pressure, the same results there where there was just about a 2 millimeter difference between the denervation group and the sham group. So even when you aggregate blood pressures over the course of a day,
right,
24 hours, there was no difference. So what will happen now with renal denervation and the treatment of resistant hypertension?
Well, it's hard to say what will happen. I would say what should happen is that if this was to be a procedure that is being considered for potential therapy, we need more clinical trials. We need additional trials, maybe in selective populations. As we dissect through this information from this trial, we might find that there may be populations that might be more likely than others to benefit. But really go back a little bit, take two steps back to the drawing board, redesign a trial to look carefully once again at whether this is a technique that may be appropriate for some patients.
Well, you know, I did notice that when they separated out by ethnicity, about a quarter of the participants were African American, and their difference between the two procedures was a plus 2 millimeters of mercury, and the non-African American groups was about a minus 6 millimeters of mercury between the denervation and the sham. So it does indicate there may be differences in the pathophysiology of hypertension wherein this procedure may show more benefit than in others.
Right, and that's a very important point. I think it'd be wrong to generalize that the pathophysiology of resistant hypertension is the same in everyone and in all populations. And in African American populations in particular, we know that salt sensitivity plays a very important role. And whether or not one should anticipate that they would have as a greater response as other populations may not be correct.
Well, we certainly have lots more to learn. So thank you for talking with me today, and thank you from ACC 14.